بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأصلي وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تمسك بسنته إلى يوم الدين. We enter into Surah Al-Fil, 105th Surah of the Quran, a Meccan Surah which entails 5 verses. First, we want to try to build the relationship or the link between this Surah and the previous Surah that occurred, or we discuss Surah Al-Humazah. The previous Surah, Surah Al-Humazah, speaks about the punishment, Narullah Al-Muqada, that fire of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ignited fire of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inside Al-Akhirah, for the punishment, or the punishment will be given to those individuals for those traits which are mentioned inside that surah. وَيْلُلْ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ, for those who backbite, who slander, who gossip, who spread rumors and tales, etc. And those الَّذِي جَمَعَ مَالًا وَعَدَّدًا, who think that their wealth is going to make them live forever. So there in that surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about punishment inside Al-Akhirah. Inside this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the physical punishment being shown upon this earth. And this is sunnah Allahi ala al-ardi wa fi al-samai. This is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ala al-dunya wa fi al-akhirah, in this world and the hereafter, to show punishment and reward in this world and likewise inside al-akhirah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inside this surah shows the believers and shows specifically the Quraysh that those who disobey, those who rebel, those who transgress, those who oppress, then my punishment will be exposed to those individuals upon this dunya. As we know, such statements that exist, the anger or the acts of God, whereby why does the anger of God, as they say, befall the earth? Because of sins, of transgression, of oppression, of tyranny, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins to then punish the world or punish the people on the face of the earth to make them to return back and see that there is a mighty force, a more powerful one above the people upon this earth. So that is what this surah is trying to highlight. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing that وَمَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّا هُ. None knows who the soldiers, the troops of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who they are. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't need a mighty force or a mighty army. Other places inside the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the malaika inside Surah Al-Mudathir, that we find that there are 19 angels that are guarding over Jahannam, or 19 angels that will come down. And at other times in this surah, Allah shows that He can just use تَرْمِيهِمْ بِحِجَارَةٍ مِّن سِجِّيلٍ وَأَرْسَلْ عَلَيْهِمْ طَيْرًا أَبَابِيلٍ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent upon them flocks of birds, that He destroyed this huge, great big army via these small birds carrying these small stones inside their beaks and inside their claws, and destroying this huge army of Abraha, as we're going to discuss. So this shows that the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of how He can destroy whatever He wants to destroy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and people have gone beyond the limits. So we find that this concept of open or apparent sinning, that also leads to open apparent wiping out. So if you read the qissa of Fir'aun, of Nimrud, of Qarun inside the Quran, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed these individuals who began to transgress and began to oppress openly inside society. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed them. If you read about Qawm Lut, the people of Lut, what is known in English language as the area of Sodom and Gomorrah, if you read how these people, they were destroyed because of the evil fahishad, the evil action that they were carrying out. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't necessarily need to destroy people via these natural disasters, as some people may call them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what is known is what we're even facing at the moment, pandemics and epidemics and plagues and diseases can be spread out on the earth and begin to destroy people. And thus some of the ulama have gone to review that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't send physical birds upon Abraha and his troops and his army to destroy them. He sent down a form of a disease that was brought down upon them, and it began to destroy and kill them. And this was the view of Muhammad Abdu, Imam Razi, inside his tafsir begins to discuss this as well, even though this is not the more accurate view, but there is some inclination of truth in this element, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can wipe out nations and people via affliction that can befall them. Even though in this ayah we take it literally that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did physically send these birds to destroy these individuals. So Surah Al-Fil, as we mentioned, is Meccan Surah, 5 verses, and the common name is Al-Fil, which is known, and other ulama call it Alam Tara Kaifa, call it by that name as well. This Meccan Surah, Bila Khilaf, that all of the Mufassireen are unanimous that this is a Meccan Surah sent down. As for Sabab al-Nuzul, as we know that we're going to speak about the story of Abraha, which obviously was before a revelation given to the Prophet ﷺ, but there are some narrations which speak about referring to this incident whereby when the Prophet ﷺ entered or made Sulh Hudaybiyah, and his riding beast was not the riding beast was not moving the camel. So he said, "Inna Allah habasa and Makkah al-Fil," that what is prevented, yani the my riding beast from carrying on, because this is a location where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prevented the elephant from entering into Makkah and trying to harm Makkah. So my riding beast has also, yani qaswa, my riding beast has also stopped at this same location out of respect, or maybe possibly out of fear, that not to go beyond this precinct or go through this environment. So this is something which shows that the story of the elephant was known to the Prophet ﷺ and was known to Quraysh. And actually this incident took place, as Imam Sabuni mentions, yani, known as the year 570 Christian era, which coincides with the birth of the Prophet ﷺ, was born on Amul Fil, the year of the field. And this was a common Arab practice that they, from this moment, tarikhiyan, they began to have a form of a calendar system they had. They refer to, yani, hasala hada fi Amul Fil, this took place in Amul Fil, or ba'dahu amain, or happened 2 years after, yani, Ashabul Fil. So this was their form of a calendar that they began to base upon this great big incident that took place, that the Quraysh, they visualized. And remember, many of the Quraysh, yani, are now physically still living, who visualized what took place, at this destruction of Abraha and his army. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins by surah by mentioning Alam tara kayfa fa'ala rabbuka bi ashabil fil, yani alam tara, don't they visualize. But huna it carries the meaning alam tukhbir, have they not been informed. Alam ta'lam, don't they know, meaning that there are many individuals who are living who physically they visualize this atrocity took place. Just like in today's time, we have a few people still living from World War II who visualize, who were there at that time, who can narrate to other people. So when they narrate to us, it's as if we are physically there, or that information becomes first-hand information. So this khitab to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, alam tara, don't you see, don't you have information, has it not come to you, is it not people that they can highlight and they can corroborate that this is a true fact that took place to the people Ashabul Fil and the people of Quraysh, who visualized what was taking place at that time. So we find that if we look at the reason of this surah, meaning that the whole context of this surah, which is known to the Quraysh, there was an individual named Abraha. As Imam Tabari inside his tarikh, or inside his tafsir, he mentions it, and likewise Ibn Kathir speaks about inside his tafsir as well, that Abraha was from the land of Yemen, and he was a Christian, and he basically became agitated that people go to the Kaaba, and honor and dignity was given to the Kaaba. And so he built this great big kanisa. He asked the Najashi, and Najashi is the title of the leader of the Ethiopians at that time. So the title of Najashi refers to any, the king of Najashi is a title given, just like we find Fir'aun is a title which is given, Qaisar or Kisra is title to the Romans, to the Persians. So he consulted with Najashi that he wants to build a great big church inside Yemen, and he wants, you know, some funds and donations, etc., to be given to him, and seeks his blessings, etc., to do this act so he can spread unique Christianity inside the society there. So he built a great big a church, Kanisa, and they used to call it by the name of Qulais, Bishadda, Bitashteed of the Lam, or Qulais. And Ibn Kathir mentioned that they're given this name because you really had to look up to the height of this building and the magnitude of this building at how huge and grand this building was. But unfortunately for Abraha, this building still did not compete with the Arabs flocking from Yemen and other areas, the Arabian Peninsula, to come to the Kaaba to make tawaf. And at this moment in time, we ignore the form of tawaf, how they were doing, and the ibadah they were doing. There was still a huge element of reverence and respect that was given to the Kaaba over other religious sites or other religious buildings. And some of them, they mentioned that some of the Arabs, disrespected the church, and this enraged Abraha even more. So he decided now to go and physically go and attack the Kaaba. So he brought to his army. And some of them write a elephant was brought over from Ethiopia or from Africa, and they used it. And some say there was maybe more than one elephant. Some even go to view there's 12 elephants is one that exists. And even the name of the elephant, Ibn Kathir speaks about the name of the elephant being called Mahmud. And Allah alam about the authenticity about this, but this is something that he's mentioned that his tafsir, and other ulama have mentioned this as well. Shaykh Uthaymeen rahmatullah mentioned that there were six elephants in total that were there. And plus the main elephant could have been 7, all the way up to, as we mentioned, to 12 or 13 elephants were there, or could have just been a single elephant. So he came with this huge, elephant with the intent to begin to come and destroy it, you need the Kaaba. Now I'm sure most of us are familiar with the story, what took place, and then he met Abdul Muttalib and went to discuss with him, you need to come to some agreement, etc. And so when he first saw Abdul Muttalib, he saw him as a very smart, a very intelligent individual. But when Abdul Muttalib would say that, "I just want you to return back my 100 camels that you've taken by force, you know, and then, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then leave everything the way it is." So Abu Rahab said, "I thought you were a very intelligent individual, but when I see that you're requesting your own protection, not worried about the Kaaba and the precinct, it shows there's a lack of intelligence, you know, within you." So Abdul Muttalib said, ana rabbul ibl, I am the master and the lord of these camels, of this flock. Wa rabbul bayt, and there's rabbul bayt alladhi yahmihi, and there's a lord of the house who is going to protect the house. So I don't need to worry about that. I leave my affair to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alam tara kayfa fa'ala rabbuka bi ashabil fil. So here you find an element of tawheed existed amongst these people. They recognize a superior power over their idols, their idolatry, the shirk that they're committing, that there is one who is all powerful above all this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the khitab here mentions rabbuka bi ashabil fil. Did you not see what your Lord done with the companions of the field? So in Abraha tried to push the elephant forward to try to come and attack the Kaaba. It wouldn't move. He pushed it to the right. It would move to the right. Directed back to the Kaaba, wouldn't go towards the Kaaba. Pushed it to the left, would walk. Pushed it towards the Kaaba, wouldn't walk, etc. All directions, but the elephant would not move. And all of a sudden, a great big storm, a flock of darkness inside in the sky, it came. And you find that these birds, tarmihim bi hijarat min sijil, وَأَرْسَلَ عَلَيْهِمْ طَيْرًا أَبَابِيلَ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent these flock of birds upon any the tribe or the army of Abraha. وَأَرْسَلَ عَلَيْهِمْ طَيْرًا أَبَابِيلَ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then sent these birds in flocks, jama'at, upon Abraha, and inside their beak was these stones, and inside their claws were stones that were thrown upon any these individuals, alam yaj'al kaydahum fi tadlil, and made their plotting and their planning to come to no avail. Wa arsala alayhim tayran ababil tarmim bi hijaratin min sijil. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed the plotting and planning of these individuals, what they were planning any to do. Here some of the mufassirin begin to discuss that, how is it possible that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them preference, the Quraysh preference over Ahlul Kitab, the people of the book? Because here we find Quraysh are idolaters, mushrikun. Ahlul Kitab here are the Christians here specifically. And obviously we find that Islam shows more preference towards Ahlul Kitab over the people who commit shirk. So here the ulama begin to discuss that because the intent of Abraha was to dismantle and destroy the Kaaba, so preference was given to the Quraysh over Ahlul Kitab, because he was coming as an oppressive individual to try to annihilate, trying to destroy the Kaaba, trying to wipe out the remnants of the Kaaba. So he obviously had to be removed. Imam Sa'di mentions that this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed this to take place as a precursor for the coming of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So people could narrate that this is it, because this event, as we mentioned, is the same year that the Prophet ﷺ was born. And obviously historically they began to narrate and speak about the historical data and information from Amul Fil. So just like they know about Suratul Fil, or they know about companions Ashabul Fil, likewise they know that this is a special, this must have been a special moment as well, because this was the time that the Prophet ﷺ was born as well. Alam yaj'al kaydahum fi tadlil, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused their plotting and their planning to be null and void, to be nullified. And this is, as Shaykh Uthaymeen mentioned, a verse inside the Quran that we can apply such verses, that whoever tries to plot and plan against the symbols of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make them busy with their own plotting and their planning and make it be wasted away. وَمَنْ يُرِدْ فِيهِ بِإِلْحَادٍ بِظُلْمٍ نُذِكْهُ مِنْ عَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ. As you find inside Surah Al-Hajj, 22nd chapter, whoever wants to carry out any form of oppression, any form of wrongdoing, then we will overcome these individuals and give them a severe punishment. And a side point, if you look at Surah Al-Hajj, 22nd chapter, you find so many ayat inside there speaking about Hajj, speaking about the Kaaba, speaking about respecting the symbols of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَنْ يُعَظِّمْ حُرُمَاتِ اللَّهِ فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَّهُ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِ. Whoever respects the symbols of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is better for the individual. And then again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, وَمَنْ يُعَظِّمْ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ فَإِنَّهَا مِنْ تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ. Whoever respects the symbols of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is from piety of the heart. So on this basis, the Quraysh were given that respect because they were respecting the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And indeed, this gave them a preference. We're going to look inside Surah Quraysh, the next surah, how this preference was given to them because of the protection of the Kaaba by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because at the time the Quraysh are in charge of the Kaaba, that this spread then inside the Arabian Peninsula, this honor and privilege has been given to the people, you know, of Quraysh. وَأَرْسَلَ عَلَيْهِمْ طَيْرًا أَبَابِيلَ. As we mentioned, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent upon them birds, jama'at. Some of the ulama that begin to discuss, like Imam Razi and other ulama begin to discuss, so Imam Shawkani begins to discuss the type of birds, the size of the birds, etc. And this type of ilm, لَمْ يَنْفَعَ, this type of knowledge doesn't really benefit individuals of the breed of the bird, the type of the bird, the size of the bird, the color of the bird, etc. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to describe it, He would have mentioned it inside the Quran, just like we find Ashab al-Kahf, the people of the cave, the young individuals. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inside this spoke about the dog, doesn't begin to discuss the nature or the breed or the type of dog, as Imam Razi inside his tafsir, he begins to speak about this. So many of the ulama tafsir, they say when mufassirin who begin to have this any in-depth discussion about certain things which the Quran just gives a general ruling about it or general description, there's no need to enter into it, because then the person may begin to rely upon false narrations or rely upon Israelite traditions which may be authentic, may not be authentic. And as we mentioned at the same time, it's a knowledge that doesn't increase one in spirituality or benefit an individual to such a degree. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned tarmihim bihijaratin min sijil, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed them, yani with bihijaratin, with small pebbles, small stones, min sijilin, which are heated. Abu Bakr Jazari mentions bi sijin, that these are taken from Jahannam, these stones. Thus we find that some of the ulama they mentioned describing this story, that when these stones would hit them, it would go penetrate into their flesh, and at the same time it would burn them, it would char them, and enter into them. And that's what we find majority of the army, that they perished or died. And Abraha was injured so immensely that he left the precinct in the area, and on his way back towards Yemen, somewhere along the line, that he passed away. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing that his qudra and his power, that how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took ashabul fil, the companions of the elephant, and destroyed them via small birds. Just as we began with that Namrud, some of the ulama tafasir, they mentioned that Namrud, this individual who used to boast about that kingdomship has been given to me, and said, Ana uhyi wa umid, I'm the one that gives life and death, when his discussion with Ibrahim alayhi salam. They say that some of the ulama tafasir, they mentioned just a small fly entered into his nose and disturbed him and caused his death. So this individual who owns this great big kingdom, this individual who claims qala ana uhyi wa umit, I'm the one that gives life and death, look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed this individual. Likewise Fir'aun, as we mentioned at the beginning, look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed Fir'aun, boasting about, look at my palace, it's on top of the river, and the rivers flowing underneath me and my power, etc. For how did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroy him? فَغَرَقَهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that which he was boasting about, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed him in that same, or in the Red Sea, destroyed him with the same water that he was boasting about. So this is sunnatullahi lal-ard, that those individuals who begin to oppress or begin to transgress, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala كَمَا تَدِينُ تَدَان, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just like you behave or how you conduct yourself, then you find that your punishment will be similar, will be exposed upon those individuals. فَجَعَلَهُمْ كَأَصْفٍ مَعْقُولٍ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made these individuals to be chewed up and totally, that there's no remnants left of them. So here some of the ulama begin to speak about what is كَأَصْفٍ مَعْقُولٍ. Imam Razi mentions inside the Quran, Surah Al-Rahman, Allah mentioned الْحَبُّذُ الْأَصْفِ وَالْرَيْحَانِ, speaking about the blessings of paradise, of having corn and leaves and stalks, and والريحان, sweet plants. So here we find walhabu dhul asfi, that this becomes totally in small elements, just like you find that on the leaf or wrapping on a seed, on a piece of grain, etc. That we find, that's how small, how perished they were, or they were stamped or stampeded upon, so they were crushed, and then on top of that, they were stampeded, meaning that there's hardly any remnants of these individuals that is left. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala severely destroyed these individuals because of their arrogance, because of their pride, and because of them trying to attempt to try to destroy in the Kaaba. فَجَعَلَهُمْ كَعَصْفٍ مَأْكُولٍ, as we've mentioned, it being chewed or eaten away, total annihilation, few remnants of these individuals are left, or they're being destroyed any immensely by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this, as we mentioned, is a severe warning for a person to fear the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that could befall those individuals who begin to oppress society or oppress people, or they begin to oppress and they mar people away from the symbols of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, numerous places inside the Quran mentions about respecting, as we mentioned inside Surah Al-Hajj, the symbols of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, showing reverence to them, not going over the limits, not making derogatory remarks. Even the Quran mentions, do not revile and curse those individuals who worship others besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inside Surah Al-An'am, which is a surah full of tawheed, lest they begin to revile and curse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So even when a person speaks about other people's idols or their belief, etc., there's still an element of respect that exists there, especially for people Ahlul Kitab, that there is a concept of belief in God, in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though it may be tainted with shirk, but there is a core element that the recognition of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in conclusion, we find that some of the lessons that we learn from the surah that we find is a form of tasliya, a form of encouragement to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. أما يلاقيه من الظلم يعني كفار قريش. There's a form of encouragement to the Prophet عليه السلام that just like previous nations or people were destroyed because of their oppression or trying to harm believing individuals, that this is now strengthening the Prophet عليه السلام, that remember this in Meccan surah, that the hardship, the difficulty that you're facing, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of the affair, will take care of the matter. Wallahu ya'simuka min an-nas, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect you from the people, will protect this deen. So this is a form of encouragement to the Prophet عليه السلام. Likewise, istadhkir li Quraysh, it is a lesson and reminder to the Quraysh, as we mentioned, that some of them were still living after this incident, so they can narrate or they can relate to this incident. So there should be element of fear should exist amongst them, because now the Prophet ﷺ is mentioning his verses from the Quran as revelation brought down to him by Jibreel ﷺ, and narrating this, which they are fully aware of this narration, or fully aware of this qissa, because some of the other stories could be of Thamud, of Ad, they're familiar with them because they're in the Arabian Peninsula, but they're slightly far away from the meaning. They could have existed hundreds or maybe thousands of years prior to them. So they can, to a certain degree, and relate to them, but not more so as the story of Ashab al-Fil, which is something which is directly that some of them are still living at that moment in time. Also, we find thirdly, in conclusion, this shows any mudaharatu qudratullahi subhanahu wa ta'ala, shows the manifestation of the strength and the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yani on those individuals who try to plot and plan against Islam, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will seek any retribution upon those individuals, may even do it inside his dunya, destroy them inside his dunya. If not, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inside al-akhirah will judge them and give the due punishment as given to them for their atrocities, for their oppression, for their tyranny, for their hardship, and harming other individuals or harming the symbols and the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tawfiq and ability to respect and to revere and to honor and to magnify and to glorify the symbols of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the symbols of the adhan, of the prayer, the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Wa qulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa li jami'il muslimina fastaghfiruhu innahu huwal ghafurur rahim.